Welcome to part three of our video series. We'll continue our review of the PCI Express Gen 5 specification-based IBIS-AMI models. My name is Todd Bourbonsolo, and I'm an application engineer here at Keysight in the Design Engineer Software Services Group. In this video segment, I'll go into more detail on the elements in the PCI Express Gen 5 base specification that were used in the development of the IBIS-AMI model. Let's begin. Let's take a closer look at the particular specification items that go into an IBIS-AMI model. Out of the 1,299-page document, only about 30 to 50 pages were referred to for the AMI model building. The electrical specification topics are listed here to the left, along with their page number in the base specification for future reference. Transmit equalization. It consists of a three-tap FIR filter, so you have a precursor, a cursor, and a post-cursor. The table shows how the preset settings map to pre-shoot and de-emphasis equalization levels. A graph from SystemVue is provided showing the pulse response of all 10 presets. Receiver CTLE. In the specification, it's captured as a frequency domain transfer function. Two zeros and four poles are defined. The DC gain controls the placement of the second zero. The plot on the left is from the PCI Express specification, and on the right is using the transfer function from the spec, plotting the frequency response in the system view. As you can see, they match perfectly. The final graph is the pulse response behavior of the different CTLE settings. Receiver clock data recovery. So the graph on the left is the CDR function from the spec. A key characteristic for the 32 giga transfer curve is the minus 3 dB point is at 10 megahertz. The plot on the right is the CDR behavior modeled in SystemVue. The SystemVue model has a parameter adjustment, so what is shown is the sweeping of that CDR sensitivity parameter and its corresponding frequency behavior. So for this setup, a CDR adjust value of 200 nicely meets the 32 giga transfer spec, which was actually used in the final model. The jitter transfer behavior was generated by sweeping the frequency in a time domain analysis. So some example plots of that time domain analysis are shown in the lower right. You can see for this left graph, the jitter is at 1 megahertz, and you can see that it has a noisy input, but a very stable output. So it's tracking the jitter. When that jitter increases to 1 gigahertz, you see now that actually it no longer tracks it and it passes it through. So this is an illustration of that time domain behavior, which was captured in the frequency curve. Receiver decision feedback equalization. So previously for Gen 4, a two-tap DFE was assumed. Now for Gen 5, a third tap is added. Previously, a constant millivolt limit was assumed for the DFE coefficients, but for Gen 5, there's now a ratio requirement. The ratio is H1 over H0 must be less than 0.8, which is a tap 1 magnitude over the cursor strength. This restriction is to help protect from error bursts, although the spec mentions specific designs may need to do their own analysis on the largest safe H1 to H0 ratio. At any rate, the ratio of H1 over H0 less than 0.8 was implemented in the receiver model. The calculation is made available to users through the AMI parameter output. For each simulation, the user can plot tap 1 limits, which is shown here in the red curve, alongside the DFE coefficients, which is the other curves, to observe their behavior over time. Jitter components. So the PCI Express jitter values are captured on the tables on the left. The specification refers to both high frequency and low frequency jitter at the transmitter and articulates it as pulse width jitter. So to align with IBIS-AMI jitter parameters, a conversion is made to generate the values on the table on the right. So for clarity in the conversion process, the table on the lower left is actually duplicated and placed next to the table on the right. colored lines show the mapping of the PCI Express spec values to the IBIS-AMI TX and RX components. You'll notice in some cases there's a factor of 1/2 or a factor of 1 over square root of 2 needed for the conversion. This is to convert pulse width jitter to edge jitter, which is needed for time domain simulations. The high frequency jitter was separated out and referenced to the transmitter. The low frequency jitter was separated out and used at the receiver. And then also at the receiver is the reference clock random jitter. And these jitter parameter column has those clarifications captured. And so the total jitter using this process for an e to the minus 12 comes out to 9.66 picoseconds, which is 31% of the unit interval. I height and I width targets. Lastly is the spec requirements for the pass fail I height and I width. These values are shown at this bottom table. For 32 gigatransfer, the I height requirement is 15 millivolts peak to peak and 9.375 picoseconds I width. The spec defines a range for measuring the I height with a maximum value taken within plus or minus 0.1 UI from UI mean center. The I mask that was put together for usage in ADS is shown in the lower right figure. This concludes part 3. Please join me for the next video, and we'll continue to explore these PCI Express Gen 5 IBIS-AMI models. Thanks.